taught so many years at the college, and each one was a little different. And so you could walk up and down the walls of the chapel and see hundreds of names of people who had dedicated their lives to teaching. And each one was a little different, and there was one in particular that caught my eye. And it had a quote on it. I forget the name of the professor. I have no idea who he was or what he taught. But he had a little quotation from Socrates on his memorial plaque. And the quote from Socrates said, "It is not living that is to be considered the most important thing, but it is living well." And so, if you read Socrates, if you read Plato's account of Socrates, Socrates was quite interested in this question: what does it mean to live well, to live a good life? And he had his own ideas about that. He tried to encourage people to think about that so that they would live a life that was worth living, and not just fritter away their life in things that weren't really good. In fact, Socrates felt that people would automatically try their best to live a good life. It just depends on what your definition of good is. It depends on what you think a good life is. And if you look at people, and you look at the choices that they make in their life, you will see from their choices and decisions that they make, you will be able to tell exactly what that person thinks is good. But the good life, brothers and sisters, the good life is undoubtedly what we are all striving for. It's simply a question of what is that good life? What is the good life? Advertising tells us various and sundry ideas for what would constitute a good life. The world around us, television, the internet, we're constantly being presented with ideas about what the good life is and what we should be striving for. Well, brothers and sisters, tomorrow in the church's year, the church's life, we celebrate a great feast of our Lord Jesus Christ, the feast of his Transfiguration. And this feast, the Lord takes three of his closest disciples, the Apostle Peter, the Apostle James, and the Apostle John. And he takes these three apostles up. They walk up the mountain of Tabor. And there on the mountain of Tabor, as they are in prayer, the Lord Jesus is transfigured before them. He becomes shining with white, shining with light. The Gospel in the King James Version, I think I mentioned last year, the King James Version of the Gospel account says that Jesus was glistering. He was shining so much, he was glistering. Well, brothers and sisters, then the apostles fall down in fear. A cloud comes, a cloud representing the Holy Spirit, and they find themselves surrounded by the grace of the Holy Spirit, and they hear the voice of the Father from heaven, "This is my beloved Son, hear him." This is the feast, brothers and sisters, that we celebrate tomorrow, and we will have a liturgy for the feast tomorrow morning at 9:30. But I wanted to go ahead and talk about it a little bit today, because of a particular reason. And one thing is that if you look at the meaning of the Feast of the Transfiguration, part of the reason why Jesus took the disciples up the mountain and was transfigured before them was to show them, to show us who he really is. That is to say, the light that Jesus was shining with was not an ordinary light. We see light all the time, every day of our life, we see light. But the light that was shining from Jesus was a different kind of light. Because all the light that we normally see in life is light that comes from where? It's created light. It's light that God himself made. God is the creator of the whole universe, even of light itself. But the light that came from Jesus Christ is a different kind of light, because it is an uncreated light. light that he shines with his Father and the Holy Spirit, for all eternity. It is the uncreated light of God. And so on the mountain, Jesus is showing who he really is, and that when that uncreated, glorious light is streaming from him, brighter than the sun, then the apostles are confronted with the fact that he is the Son of God. The light of God's glory streams from his face, from his divine body, so that they will understand that 40 days later, when they see him on the cross, they will understand he is truly God and not be totally lost in sandalwood and crushed. But the other reason, brothers and sisters, why we celebrate this feast, and the other reason why Jesus goes up on the mountain, it's not just to show who he himself is, but he goes up the mountain and is transfigured before the disciples to show the future. Not just his own future, but our future. Because brothers and sisters, that light, that uncreated light of the glory of God streaming from Jesus Christ is precisely gift that God has in mind for us, for each and every one of us. God's intention for us, and we can confound his intention, we can go against his intention, but God's intention for each and every one of us is that each and every one of us should be streaming with the uncreated light of God's grace for all eternity. That's his plan. Each and every one of us. You look around the people in church this morning, and imagine for a moment. Not the physical bodies that you see, but imagine looking into the face of each other and seeing the light that's brighter than the sun streaming from your face, streaming from the face of everyone in this room that you're looking at. That is God's intention. And it's not that, therefore, that heaven, we think of heaven, it's going to be like this world, but just a little bit better. But what the Lord is telling us is this is our future. This is what he has in mind for us, and it is incredible. It is unspeakable. It is beyond beauty. It is beyond joys. It is not just that we won't suffer anymore. It's that we will be in the fullness of joy. It's not that we won't fall in sin. It's that we will be surrounded by the fullness of righteousness, of God's righteousness. It's not just that, you know, we won't have little annoyances in life. But brothers and sisters, the fullness of peace in God, as we are surrounded by the glory of God, and we participate and are sharers in the very glory of God. That's what God has in mind for us. And brothers and sisters, what we should be aware of, what we should be confessing and knowing with all of our heart, all of our mind, is that that is the good life. That is the life that is worth living. And whatever the world tries to sell us, whatever the world tries to sell us, make us think that it's great and it's wonderful and it's worth pursuing and putting our heart on. It's not. That's not the good life. What this world has to offer, the greatest thing that this world has to offer, is dumb in comparison to the blessed and joyous light of life that our God has in store for us. So brothers and sisters, do not let us be deceived and follow after things that are fleeting.